Bwana asifiwe.
Amen.
Unaweza kuketi. I thank God for the opportunity to be here again. I was here with my wife in December. It was fantastic. And I keep coming back because I have a lot of interests in the country. In addition being of being a minister, I am also an investor. So it's not bad to be an investor when you are a minister. We have an example in the Apostle Paul, who was he is the great apostle, and he was a tent maker. And so today I brought the greetings last Sunday, so today I will bring the word of God. The bishop tells me I have several minutes, so I will use those minutes well. Last time I preached for too long, and the bishop cushioned me, so today I will compensate, I will preach short. Usually we in my church we preach about 30 minutes. So I'm used to preaching for 30 minutes, so I should be okay. Today I want to bring you the word of God from the 40th chapter of the book of the prophet Isaiah. I'll be referencing the whole chapter, but I want to bring you from, I want us to read just verses 27 through 31, which says, I'm reading from the NIV version. The scripture says, why do you say, O Jacob, and complain, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord. My cause is disregarded by my God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar up on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. Amen? And many times we read, when we read this chapter, those are the verses that we reference. But if you read the beginning of the chapter, it starts by saying, comfort, comfort my people. And that's what I want to do. I want to comfort God's people. I want to bring a word of encouragement to you today. Because this chapter is about giving you comfort, encouraging you, and pointing you to a God who can give you comfort. Human beings, we face many troubles. We are born to a world where, as some people say, it's a rat race. You are running, and you are tired, and you are hustling, and you are trying to make life. So there is a restlessness that we are born with. Even as a child is born, they cries. And as it starts to grow, there is a restlessness. There is a wrestling. There is a fighting for space. There is a fighting for resources. It's a fighting for opportunities. So we find that we are in a constant state of struggle. We are in a constant state of trying to find a place for ourselves in this world. Because as the economists will tell you, the resources are scarce. But the needs are always greater than the resources. So there is always a tension that is there between what we want and what we have. But God is sending us a word of comfort today. You see, throughout the scripture, God is always saying, I want to bring my people to a place of rest. Jesus said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Because he knows we are restless people. Sometimes we lose sleep because we are thinking, how can I make my ends meet? I think I'm not alone. Maybe I've told you before, I worry a lot. Many of my friends tell you, I prepare a lot. If I was going to build a house, I dig deep the foundation. Maybe you're like me. So sometimes I'm restless. But God is calling us to a place of comfort. He says, comfort, comfort, comfort my people. So the words that we read are starting from a discussion of a people who are restless. These were the children of Israel who had gone into exile. And they were restless because they thought God was not seeing their problems. They thought God was not likely to attend to their problems. And maybe you have been praying. Maybe you have been waiting. Maybe you've been looking forward. And it has looked like it's too long. And it looks like there's no help coming from any place. There's no help coming from any quarter. As this man in the Bible said, I have no man to help me get into the well. When the angel stirs the water, I have no one to help me. As I have said before, he's like every Kenyan. He said, I have no one. I have no man. I don't know a minister. I don't know an MCA. I don't know anyone who can help me. He said, I have no man until Jesus came. Amen? And Jesus comes at those times when we have no man, when we have no one who can help us. We can see help somewhere, but we have no one to help us. Jesus comes at that time and bridges a gap. That's why he says, come unto me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And what the burdens you're carrying, we carry different burdens. Those of us who have grown children, it happens very much in the U.S. My children grew up in the U.S., so I can relate to the kind of worries we have. They start driving at the age of 16. So the first thing, only time you hear a call, you start shaking at night because you don't know what the daughter or the son has done. Whether they have crashed in the car or whether they have crashed someone, that's the main fear among parents who have teenagers in the U.S. Anytime you have a call, the first thing you worry, what has he done? What has she done? And I know the same here with parents here. Maybe you worry about different things. So we parents worry a lot. I keep reminding my friends not to refer to their children who are above 18 as children. Because if you continue calling them children, then you continue worrying even the more. These are grown people. These are adults. And God is calling you to a place of rest where you can release them and start resting, where you can release them and stop worrying. Comfort, comfort my people. These were people who were exiled. And they had lost hope because they thought God was not seeing their problems. Not only did they not think that God was not seeing their problem, they thought he was unlikely to help them. If you read the chapter 40, you will find that this is a discussion that's going on with these people of God. God is, the scripture reveals that these people had fallen in a state of hopelessness, a state of feeling rejected and very low in their spirits. I don't know whether you are in that place where you feel your hope has been taken away. The scripture reveals that they had fallen into this state because of two things. They had forgotten who they were, and they had also forgotten where they had come from. You find that the Lord is addressing them and saying, O Jacob, O Israel. He's reminding them that they are a people of covenant. They had forgotten how God has sworn that he will be with them. He will never leave them nor forsake them. They had become hopeless because they had forgotten who they were. Sometimes we forget the promises of God. Sometimes we forget who we are. Sometimes we forget the trust that we have in God that he will carry us through. It's because we forget who we are many times that we are the children of God and that we are in the hands of God. And that is what causes the heart of hopelessness in our hearts. As long as you remember that your father has a cattle on 1,000 hills and silver and gold belong to him, you will always remain hopeful. Amen? You always remain hopeful. It might not be today. It might not be this week. But because you believe in God, Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled because you believe in God. So long as you believe in God, so long as you belong to God, things might be, the storms might be raging, but your hope will not be lost. Keep hope alive. Keep up alive if you believe in God. They had lost their hope because they had forgotten whom they were. Never forget who you are. That you are a child of God. That you are in the palms of his hands. That every day he's moving, his eyes are moving to and fro in the whole earth, looking for someone on whom he might show his strength. Amen? He's looking around. These people had fallen, had become dejected. They had lost hope because they thought, God does not care anymore. You read the chapter and you find that they had fallen into a state of hopelessness. They thought God does not care at all. We are in exile. Maybe as Kenyans, you feel things have been very difficult. Corruption is in many places. Someone told me corruption is going down. I want to pray that is the case. And I want to pray that it will continue to be that way. And many things as we prayed here for the country. Maybe you feel things are difficult. And these people were in exile and they felt it was a very difficult situation. But worse, they thought God was unlikely to help them, that God did not care. Many times we feel like that. But I want to tell you, the Lord reminds us. And the discussion in this chapter is where God is telling his people, remember who you are and remember where you have come from. It is by you seeing back where God has taken you from that you can now regain your hope and your courage. By looking back where you were and where you are, although all things have not gone on well the way you want, but you can look back and give thanks. You can look back and say, Ebenezer, that where I am, I would not be here if God did not help me. Where I am, unless God was with me, I would not have reached here. If you can say that, then you can also regain your hope again. And say, whatever remains, the journey that remains, the same God who was with me is the one who will take me to where I want to. Take courage. Be encouraged today. Regain your hope again by looking back and seeing where God has taken you from. These people had fallen into hopelessness because they had forgotten whom they were and they had forgotten how God has taken them out of captivity there before and how he had rescued them, how he had blessed them, how he had given them food in the wilderness because they had forgotten. Because they had forgotten. Because they had forgotten. Have you forgotten the blessings of the Lord? The psalmist say, oh my soul, remember, forget not all his benefits. Forget not. Speak to your spirit and say, my soul, forget not his benefit. Today I thank God that I'm healthy. Today I thank God that I'm strong. Today I thank God that my mind is sound. There are many things you can thank God for. Oh my soul, forget not his benefit. And as I remember the benefit that he has bestowed on me, as I remember the blessing that he has put in my life, I'm encouraged that even those things that I'm praying for, that God will give me again. Let hope arise out of you looking back to what God has done for you. I know all of us have dreams. All of us have aspirations. All of us have things we are praying for. But let what God has already done become an encouragement. Keep hope alive in your heart and not be rejected. Let not fear steal your hope and your joy. God calls us to a place of comfort. He calls us to a place of peace. He calls us to a place of rest. Amen? Even in the midst of the storm, God is able to shield us. We will be riding on the waves of the storm because God is with us. Peace comes from hope. Amen? Sometimes you are in the middle of a storm, but if you can see the safety boat coming, the fear is removed and hope, peace is regained because of the hope. Peace comes from hope. When you become hopeless, you become troubled, you become peaceless. Peace comes from hope. It is because we hope in God that even in the midst of trouble, we can be at peace. Someone who wanted to despise faith said, Christianity is the opiate of the people. It is like people who have been given a tranquilizer to have peace because they hope they will go to heaven. He thought he was despising, but that is the truth. That our faith becomes a tranquilizer. It gives us peace because we have a hope. A hope to go to heaven. When everything is taken away from us, we have a hope. I hope that one day we will go to God. Many people When we are in this world, sometimes heaven looks too far. But it is when we attend funerals that we realize how close heaven is at. Recently, I attended a funeral of a very close member of our family. And as we were attending the funeral, I realized how everything that I have is so useless. You can't do anything to get back that life. It looked, all the struggles I have, they're so meaningless. There's nothing I could do with everything that I have to preserve that life. And yet, being reminded by the Apostle Paul that we do not mourn like those of mankind who have no hope. It is a state of hopelessness. If you have no hope of heaven, when you go to a funeral, you should really cry. Because it shows you how fickle, how shallow life is. He says we should not mourn like those who have no hope. Those who have hope have reason not to mourn. Because we know there is a better place called heaven. Hope. Hope is alone from the future to the present. Amen? You know, when you get a loan, you start enjoying money which is not yours. Hope is a loan from the future to the present. If you tell your children you are going to Mombasa for Christmas, they start enjoying it today. Hope is a loan to the present from the future. When you lose hope, you lose your future. You start suffering a future which you have not entered. But when you have hope, you have joy and peace as a loan from the future. You have not yet embraced that which you are hoping for. You have not gone to Mombasa for your vacation, but you start enjoying it today because of that hope which is ahead. I want to encourage you to keep hope alive. Because hope keeps you going. Hope gives you strength. Hope keeps you to wake up tomorrow morning and knock on more offices. When you have no job. When hopelessness comes, you will stay in your house and say, I have tried the whole year. And I have not, nobody has given me a job. But when you keep hope alive, tomorrow you wake up and say, one more office. One more phone call. One more application. Hope is something you should never lose. Keep hope alive. Peace comes from peace. Rest comes from hope. Hope is a loan from the future to the present. Hope sustains us in the midst of the storm. It is when we are seeing where we will be that we don't mind the troubles that we are going through. Hope gives us endurance. It gives us persistence. It gives us that spirit of waiting. It is those who hope in the Lord. It is those who wait on the Lord. It gives us the ability to wait because we know a better day is coming. A better time is coming. And that gives us strength to continue with our journey. I said peace comes from hope. I want to say that faith, a hope is anchored on faith. Because faith is the assurance of things hoped for. Amen. When you have faith, then you can sustain hope. And when you have hope, you will have peace. Your heart will be at rest. Amen. If you have faith in God, as we read the scriptures this here before, if you are leaning on God, you are trusting in God, then your hope is anchored. It has got a strong anchor. It cannot be taken away. It is when you forget who you are. Oh, Jacob, oh, Israel. It's when you forget that you are connected to a God. Your faith is anchored in a God of covenant. It is when your faith is taken away. But when you remember the God who said, I am not a man that I should lie. I am not a son of man that I should repent. If you remember the God to whom you are connected, then you know that your hope is anchored in the trust in God. Because hope is anchored in faith. And peace comes from hope. Do you see the connection? Do you see where your rest is at? Your rest comes from hope. And your hope is anchored in your faith in God. So keep checking your anchor. Keep checking your foundation. Keep checking what are you hanging on. What are you leaning on? As long as you lean on Jesus, then your hope will never be shaken. Your hope will not be taken away. And that's why you can find peace even in times of trouble. Because your hope is anchored on one who cannot be shaken. Faith is the anchor. Faith is the expectation of a good outcome. Fear is the opposite of faith. Because fear is the expectation of a bad outcome. When you fear, faith and fear speak to the future. One is saying, I expect bad things. The other one is saying, I expect good things. So fear is the opposite of faith. When you find your fear, then run back to faith. Because faith is the belief, is the expectation that good things are going to happen. And fear is, both of them are about the future. Both of them are about the future. What you fear is in the future, not in the present. It is expecting that bad things are going to happen. Let us build our lives on faith. Because while we do not know about the future, the one who knows the future, we are in his hands. We don't know the future, but the one who holds the future holds us in his hands. That's why we can rejoice, even in the midst of the worst storms, even in the times of difficulty, our hope can remain alive because the one on whom we trust is the one who holds the future. Let us trade our fears for faith. Let us trust in God. Trust in God and lean not on your own understanding. In a very small book, the great evangelist, Billy Graham, speaks about three dimensions of peace. And he says, the little book is called Peace with God. He says there is a vertical dimension of peace. Peace with God. And peace with God comes from being connected to God. The Bible says there is only one mediator between us and God. Our sins have caused an enmity between us and God. Peace has been taken away. We need a Kofi Annan to come and bring us together as a mediator. The Bible says there's only one mediator between man and God, the man, Jesus Christ. Peace with God, the vertical dimension of peace. And until you find this peace, you will be restless. You will be restless. Another man said, we are restless until we find our peace in God. The same evangelist says, there is a horizontal dimension of peace. Peace with one another. As I was thinking about this morning, it came to my mind about two people who spoke. One spoke in a meeting and said, you know, I'm controversial. The evangelist says you should have horizontal peace, peace with other people. So if a person stands and says, I'm controversial, I thought the person should, instead of boasting, he should be repenting. Because when you're saying you are controversial, actually you are saying you are a troublemaker. There are the dimension of peace. Peace with one another. Peace with other people. When we have hope in God, when we trust in God, we have peace with God. And we have peace with our neighbors. Another one said, I heard, he said, in my DNA, I'm a troublemaker. Now, I thought he should be saying, I should repent, but I understand he was boasting. He thought it was a talent. He thought it was a gift. But the scripture is telling us, seek peace with all men. Seek peace. You can't boast that I'm a troublemaker. You can't boast that I am going to cause trouble to disturb the peace. You can't boast. You should be repenting. You should say, I repent. I'm ashamed that I'm a troublemaker. But you shouldn't be boasting. The third dimension of peace is internal peace. Peace with yourself. You must forgive yourself. Sometimes God has forgiven you, but you still suffer from the guilt of sin, where you remember the things you did, which no one else knows except you. You still feel bad. But God has forgiven you. You must have peace with yourself. You must forgive yourself. You must remove all guilt. For now there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Let the spirit of guilt, let the spirit of the past, let everything from the past that you did, release it to God and let him forgive you. Let him clean you and cleanse you so that you can be a free person. So that you feel you are a new and clean person. All the dirt and all the bad places you passed, let God cleanse your mind. Let God cleanse your heart. Let God cleanse your history. Let God clean you up. And also accept the cleaning. Accept the cleaning. Accept that you are clean. That God has cleansed you and has forgiven you. And you are now a clean person. Amen? So there are those three dimensions of peace. Vertical peace with God. Horizontal peace with your neighbor. And inner peace with yourself. Amen? As we hope in God. Nothing should take joy from you. Nothing should remove your joy. Nothing should remove your hope, because you are anchored in God. Because your hope is anchored in one who will never fail. As I said, this is a text about a people who were in exile, who thought God was not seeing their problem, and who thought God was not likely to help them. They had become hopeless. So it is a call today for us to find, and it was a call to them to find that God is faithful. Amen? Because you are being called, O Israel, O Jacob, a people of covenant. And it's a call that God is calling us today to remember that he's a faithful God. The scripture says, he who has spoken is faithful. His promises are yes and amen. May we today find that God is faithful. May we today discover that God is faithful. The second thing, if you read this chapter, God wanted to remind them that he is powerful. Where we read, the scripture was saying, do you not know, have you not heard, the Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He was reminding them that he is able, he is powerful. He's not only a God who promises, he's not only making a promise, but he's actually able to bring that promise to pass. And I like the way we sang several songs with Jade, that God is able to make a way where there is no way. God is able to make a way where there is no way. I know you and me today, we face situations where we do not know where the answer is going to come from. And God specializes in those kind of situations. He is able to make a way where there is no way. Or were we only singing? Did we mean it? Did we believe it? We sang several songs which say that. That God is able to make a way. We again sang when we were praying, God will make a way. Do we believe that God is able to make a way? That's what he was reminding these people. He was telling them, do not lose your hope. Because you believe in a God who is able to make a way in the wilderness. Who is able to make a way where there is no way. He was reminding them. And we reminded ourselves again when we sang that he is able to make a way in the wilderness. He is able to make a way where there is no way. Do not be discouraged that you don't see the way. Do not be discouraged that you don't know a man. You don't know anyone who can help you. Do not be discouraged that you don't see the answer. Because the one who holds you in his hands, he can make a way where there is no way. When I was young, as I said, when you are old, you repeat stories. So I don't know whether I have told you this story. So I'll tell you the story. If you have heard it before, you hear it again. And it will encourage you to spur you up again so that you can have courage. When I was going for training, I had qualified very highly. And I was called to the interview, and I did the interview, and they rejected me. So I lost my chance to get a scholarship. And I started looking now for alternatives and other things to do. But out of the blues, the then Nairobi City Council, they sat. I didn't know anybody. I lived in the slums, so I didn't have any counselor who knew me. Let me take some water so I tell you the story. Out of the blues, the city council sat again, and they increased the scholarship to one more. They increased the scholarship they had awarded to one more. They had already given some friends of mine about 5 scholarships, and there was one more scholarship which was created. I did not know anybody, and they actually called me, and they gave me the scholarship. So, if I say God can make a way where there's no way, I have seen it happen. I still wonder how it happened, but I don't know. God can make a way where there's no way. I said they had become hopeless because they had forgotten whom they were, and they had forgotten what God has done. I will never forget, when I face difficult situations, I look back to many instances where God has created a way where there was no way, and where I didn't have any person who could help me. We are being called today to gain new strength. The scripture said, it is they who wait on the Lord. It is they who hope in the Lord. I don't know whether you are one of those people. Those who wait. Those who live in a confident expectation. Do you live confident that God will come through for you? I want you to take that posture. It doesn't matter where you are now. I want you to take that posture of expectation, confident expectation that God will come through for you. Start practicing that. Start confessing that. Start living in that. And you will see you have already received a loan for the future. People wonder, why is she so happy? Did she get the job she was looking for? Did she get the admission she was looking for? People wonder. But it's because you are living in hope. You are enjoying that which is going to come. You are able to rejoice today because your hope is still alive. You are able to get a loan from the future into the present. You are able to enjoy the benefits even before you receive them, of peace and joy. It is they that wait on the Lord. They that hope in the Lord. A singer sang and said, my hope is built on nothing else but in Jesus Christ and his blood. I dare not trust anything else, because on Christ, he is the only solid rock on which I can base my faith. Everything else will be shaken. Everything else can be taken away. As I said, as I looked at my relative lying in a coffin, a beautiful young lady, talented, gifted, working in one of the best institutions, I found everything can be taken away from you, can be shaken, except your faith in God. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Let us gain hope. Let's gain confidence that God will come through for us if we our hope and our trust is in God. Amen. The text that we read concludes with an appeal and a promise. It is those who wait on the Lord. It is appealing to you and to me to trust in God. To put our hope in God and in nothing else. It is for those who wait on the Lord. What is to wait on the Lord? Is to have that expectation that God will take action. It is to refuse to run ahead of God. It is to say, sitoki hapa, usiponibariki. Amen. To wait is to hold on. I will not go on, Lord, until you bless me. Be like Jacob, who said, I will not release you until you bless me. Waiting on the Lord is to refuse to run ahead of God, to trust in God, and to wait on him. Amen? Until we receive a word, until we receive guidance, to wait is to have a confident expectation that God will come through for us. It is to refuse to run ahead of God. It is to wait and to hold on to God and say, Sitoki hapa, usiponi bariki. Amen? To wait, it is to entrust our lives in the hands of God. Our future in the hands of God. I don't know where you are passing through. I don't know what you are facing. I don't know your circumstances. But I want to say, keep hope alive. Whatever it is you are looking forward to, keep hope alive. Hope is anchored in faith. And where is your faith lying off? If your faith is in God, then your hope will be sustained. And when your hope is sustained, you will be at that place of rest. So as you move out of here, check yourself. If you are in fear, then you are not in faith. Check yourself. If you are not in peace, you are not in hope. Check yourself. If you are not in hope, you are not in faith. Amen? Because if you are in faith in God, your hope will be sustained. And that hope will give you peace. And that hope will put you to a place of rest. Amen? Let's thank God for his word. We thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you, Lord, for your word. A word that our hope is built on you. A word that our peace comes from the hope you have given us. That our hope comes from the faith we have in you. Because our faith is anchored on the rock, our hope shall be sustained. And out of that hope, we shall find rest. We shall find comfort. We shall find peace in our lives. Even in the midst of storms. Even in the midst of needs. Even in the midst of illness. Even in the midst of death, we shall find peace. Because we hope in God. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Amen. Amen. I want to join with you in prayer. Maybe there is a difficult situation you are facing. I want us to speak a word of hope about it. I want you to believe with me. That hope will rise in your heart. That God will come through. That God has not forgotten. That God sees the situation and that he will come through. Because we lose hope when we forget who we are. And we forget that God sees and he will come through with us. If there is such a need, raise your hand and mention it to God. Even as I join you in prayer. I now, Lord, pray with those who have raised their hands. Saying that you will speak hope to those difficult situations. That our lives will be, our hope will be rekindled. That our comfort will be rekindled. As we hope in God. Knowing that it is not us who are going to do it. But it is you, Lord. Because our faith is anchored in you. Our expectation is anchored on you. Our faith is in you, Lord. Our faith is in you, Lord. Our lives are in your hands. Our investments are in your hands. Our children are in your hands. Our families are in your hands. Our health is in your hands. Our very lives are in your hands, O Lord. And because we trust in you, our hope is rebuilt. Our hope is strengthened. Yes, we are being strengthened, O Lord, this day. We receive the strength of the Lord. We receive a hope of the Lord. He gives strength to the weary and he increases the power of the weak. Even young youths grow tired and weary and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. We stand by your word this day, Lord, because our faith is in you. Our hope is in you that you will regain strength this day. That we will regain peace. That we will find that place of rest where we will trust you. And look forward to you. And be able to rejoice in the expectation that you will come through for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.